Can you
you
repeat?
want to
Because it is getting lagged.
It's absolutely fine. I can repeat. We need experience. That means you need an idea of the core Java, basic Java, fundamental Java fundamentals.
Yeah, that I know.
Because some of the, if you want to do some custom components, mm-hmm. and you want to do, you want to write some business logic, you use mm-hmm. a Java format. So better to have Java knowledge.
Okay.
But in the course time also you can learn. You can browse and you can learn the basic Java.
Okay.
Going forward, you need to improve your Java skills.
Okay.
That is a prerequisite. And you have idea of XML, JSON.
Yeah. XML format, right? Where all projects
format.
They do.
Yeah.
JSON format.
You need to have idea of these XML, JSON, Java, and knowledge of the web service. What is the web service?
Yes. This open list. These are two main things.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm hearing a lot of background noise. I don't know. Your voice is clear, but there's a lot of background noise.
It's not from my side. I think now it is proper, right?
Yes. Now it's good. Okay.
Yeah.
So that is a major prerequisite of this course. You need to have basic Java knowledge, and you need to have XML and JSON.
Okay.
Not even XML, JSONs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And idea about the web services.
Yes. Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
Yes, Sachin, please. Yeah, please. Yeah. Yeah. Tell me. Yeah. Manoj, please continue. No problem.
Yeah, how many years of experience do you have?
I have totally 11 years experience complete in IT. Of my assignments on Java, Spring, these things. And I moved to Mule recently 3 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's really good. And if possible, suppose if I get a job, can you provide me with support?
Support, right? Yeah, we'll deal it separate and offline.
Okay. And can you brief me about the whole course, what all we'll see, and will I see any live projects and assignments?
Yeah. Means most of my course, I will tell the scenarios which I experienced in my project. An example from my project means if you want to tell about some transformer, some data, some concept is there inside your Mule. You want mm-hmm. to explain about data view. I took an example in my project, what type of transformations we do in project. Mm-hmm. That I will explain. Most of the examples are taken from the real time scenarios. Don't worry on that. But there should be some basic scenarios. You need to you need to do some homework on that. You need to extend those, and you need to do some extra work on the scenarios, so that you can get more.
Okay.
Yes, Sachin, please explain about the background. What?
Hello.
Yes, Sachin, please. Yeah.
Actually, I am from a IT background. I completed Masters in Management.
Okay.
Yeah, actually, I don't have any knowledge on Java.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, same. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, better guys, have some means offline only. In the course of time, you can have a lot of materials on Java online.
Okay.
Very good tutorials are there. It's mm-hmm. not a big deal to learn Java. So, spend some time regularly, about 1 hour or two, so that you can feel comfortable in the course.
Okay, we need to have Java, JSON, and XML, right? Three of them.
Yes. Java, XML, and JSON, and idea about web services. What web services do? Okay.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Code structure, I think I'm going to share my code structure. So you can have some idea what should be covering in this course.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, yes. Is my voice audible or it's low? It's hello?
Yeah, yeah.
Hello?
You can start the thing.
Yeah, okay, okay.
Can you hear?
Yes, yes, I'm able to hear clearly. What about you? Is my voice audible to you?
Yes, yes, it's audible.
Yeah, okay, okay. One second. Are you able to see my screen, right?
Yes.
So I'm showing the course contents, okay, in Excel okay. sheet. So today we start with an introduction, means why this ESB required, okay, what is the background of ESB,
okay,
what is Mule, what is the means significance of Mule in the integration platform, and a little bit about a simple, I will show the IDE where you can develop the Mule flows. And they will execute a simple program on the Mule.
Okay.
That is on the introduction section. So tomorrow I will start with the basics of the Mule. What are the basics of Mule and about Anypoint Studio and how to debug your flows. All those things and in the introduction chapter only, later part. And the thing is next we cover the concept of flows and filters. This is also a very good fundamental of Mule. You need to have a very good idea on this on concepts, flows and filters. Majorly, if interviews know, you will face questions on these fundamentals only. If you are applying for the Mule developer position, okay, and we interact with how to interact the database. We deal with how to interact the database. And afterwards, how to transform a data, XML to JSON, JSON to XML, and different about transforming data between different web services, all these things, and the routing the data, splitting, aggregating. These are all chapters, concepts covered in transformers and router. And how to develop your own SOAP-based web services and REST-based web services, and how to interact with the JMS, all these things covered in the fifth chapter. And if any error occurs, exception occurs in your program, how to deal with that. There are different exception strategies are defined, that is covered in this chapter. And how to develop your own custom components, your own transformers, your own filters, those things we covered in this seventh chapter. Okay. And unit testing framework. How to unit test your own flows, develop flows, that is called unit testing. And how if you want to develop your own APIs, how to develop your own APIs using the REST, that is covered in this RAML and API router. So for batch process, if you run a very complex process, how to do the things in the batch processing, that doing the batch processing chapter. And if you want to deploy your flows to different environments, Mule standalone environment, cloud hub, and about MMC, Mule management console, how to manage your composite in Mule management console, how to deploy, how to see logs, all this covered in the administration part. So this is the and certification guidance. If you have interest in certification, I provide the guidance for the certification. Okay. This is overall core course concepts. These are all mainly developed, taking the developer perspective. Okay, if you are going to, you're interested to take the new developer position, these are all concepts very, very useful, and you can comfortably take up that position once the course is completed. Okay, that is the motto of this course. It's not intended to the admin, okay, majorly on the developer position only. Okay, all programming concepts and the Mule concepts will be discussed as a course of this subject. Okay, it's fine.
Yes.
Okay.
Good.
Now I start with an introduction.
So, guys, so how is the job market for this in India, like in case if you see?
Yeah, what I observed is job market for Mule is booming now. If you search for any Naukri or Monster about the Mule, there is a lot of demand for the Mule professionals. There is a lot of scarcity is there for the Mule professionals. Even we are observing in our projects also. We need a lot of Mule guys, but in market, that many resources not available currently.
Okay. Okay.
And going forward, a lot of companies are adopting Mule. And there are concrete technologies are there like Oracle Sova, and there are some integration bus from IBM. Industry now is slowly adopting the Mule because of the open source and budget constraints and other factors. There are very big companies also adopting Mule nowadays. So I have going forward, there is very good market for Mule.
Mm-hmm.
In 1 or 2 years, the market will increase. Okay, there is no doubt in that.
Okay.
Because I had some lot of companies there in the Oracle Sova. My friend company is working in Oracle Sova. Now the project is moving towards the Mule.
Okay.
Sova is expensive platform. Okay, Mule is comparatively cheaper. And it offers many advantages compared to Oracle Sova. So that market is slowly moving towards Mule.
Okay, that's good.
So you can search any job portal for that. You can come to know.
Yeah. That's true.
Okay. Now.
So how many chapters are there in this? You told us 7 chapters, right? Like
about 10 chapters are there. It's not like I segregated the whole course into 10 chapters.
Okay.
But it's not like chapter. These are all one chapter may contain multiple concepts. See, this is files and flows and filters, and transformers or routers. It's more about the concepts. Yes.
Okay.
Transformers and routers. I clubbed the JMS and web services in one chapter. Some chapter contains multiple concepts. Okay.
Yeah.
So, coming to introduction. So what are you guys thinking about the Mule? Means before taking this course, right? Means you need to have some idea what you are going to do and what about this technology. Okay.
Yes.
You have any idea of the Mule, basic idea of what is an interface service bus or Mule?
Mule is an interface service bus, but don't know. Like it's an integration tool, basically. That's what I mean.
Okay, good. Integration tool. Okay. So integration tool in sense it integrates different applications, right?
Yes.
Integration. So before integration, let's discuss about some application architectures. Okay. So if you are an IT scape, means since how the architectures are evolved since 1970s, 80s, 2000 and nowadays. Okay. Initially, in 70s, 60s, there is one application is there. Okay, they develop apps, one app. Okay. This application contains the application logic and the storage. We want to store some object application itself contains the application logic and the storage space. So it any if it any uses the memory, it uses that the memory space. The whole bunch, we have the only one single application. Okay, very very initial days of the programming. Application contains the UI. UI means what the user sees, the user interface logic. Okay, UI. UI is not that much rich. What you are seeing today, some black background UI, and the logic, business logic, how to process the request, business logic, and where to store that one, all the database logic. All these three layers are clubbed in only one place. Okay, in 60s. So when the demand increases, when users increases, this architecture will not suffice, will not provide, right? So slowly what happens? Now application, UI, and business logic in one layer, and slowly developed some small databases like FoxPro and other, and start to storing that database in a different layer, databases. DBs. Okay, now your UI and business logic means UI layer, business logic in one layer, that start communicating with the database and getting the data, storing the data in separate databases. Okay, so slowly your application segregates, right? In only one part, it become two parts, database layer and the your application layer. So why this come? We can have all the things in one single application, right? Because why this happens? Any views on this architecture? Krishna Sachin?
Because since the file gets bigger, like new add-ons come, mm-hmm. I think that is why we need to segregate.
Yes. If there are limited number of users, okay, if there are 20 users or 30 or 100, 200 users, this application will be. If there are about 10,000, 1 lakh users, so your application memory requirements will grow, right? So the architecture above I defined, from this architecture, we can't serve. If the user base is growing on, your memory requirements is going on, so the application will break, right? So for that, let's say they separate some databases, and databases can support some more number of the users, so that your application can't break, right? Okay. Now, what happens is your business logic in this type of architecture. Okay. The business logic we tied with the databases. Okay. So when the user want to store some data in the system, you use the data, is the information. The information we process in the business logic, we store that information in the database. Okay, so what we did that in the business logic layer, we told boss go and store in this particular DB. Okay, or suppose tomorrow you want to change the DB, this DB to some other DB, then your business logic layer will break, right? Okay, if you want to change the DB, you need to go and change all the things what you defined in the business logic layer. Okay, so what they did is, okay, this is going, if you want to, means change is constant in the IT industry. Only one thing is change is constant. Always changes will happen. Your application requirements will change, your application demand will increase. Then you need to cope up with the change, right? So for that, what happens? sorry, it's not visible. So this is your application, means this is your user interface, means where the user interacts with system. All the screens will be stored in the this UI level. Okay, and there is one business logic layer, service layer. So where you write, you take the user input from the UI layer and you write all the business logic, what you want to process in the business logic layer, and that is sent to a database layer. This is called database layer, where you write what need to store, how to interact with the database, what we to retrieve the database, what to store the database on in the database layer. Okay, you segregated whole application into three layers: UI layer, business logic layer, and database layer. So if you have any change in UI layer, you're going to change only in this layer only. Means you want to change a new screen or you can fill up the screen, you change in the UI layer only. So it won't impact on the other layers, right? If you want to change from the database, you go and change only database layer only. So likewise, for application management purpose, slowly the architecture defined into three layers: user interface layer, business logic layer, and database layer. Okay, everything has its own responsibility. Okay, then if you change happens in one area, it doesn't affect the other areas. So application will be more stable and rigid. Okay, got right? Any ideas in this architecture? So what I'm discussing, why the Mule is evolved, what are the reasons behind this enterprise service bus, why the technology is moved to enterprise service bus from this client server architecture and this type of architectures. Okay. This all in the 1990s to 2000s application architecture is like this. And nowadays, from 2005 onwards, SOA comes into picture, means web services, lot of web services designed. So what is a web service? How it different from your normal application? Any idea of the web service? What is web service? Sachin, Manoj?
No, sir.
Web yeah. service, I know only SOAP and REST. I don't know what are those exactly.
Okay. SOAP, REST. Web service is a normal service. Means is that if you do some request, it processes the request and gives back your response. Anything. Okay, that you can call as service. Okay. So web service, you define some functionality, whatever functionality you define, that functionality that is available over internet. Means you can do that, you can request that one. You take the request and process the request and use back to the response. Okay, right, that is a web service. So what is the advantage of web service? So advantage is like, see, earlier I told you, right, there are some you can design an application for an enterprise enterprises. So if you define the functionality, you take that the user information, and you want to storing the user information to a database, for suppose. Okay, so you write some business logic, right? How to store that user information to the database. So the functionality, the scope of this functionality is limited to this application only. we can't make use of this functionality from the outside world. Okay, if you want to use this functionality, you need to come inside this application. So you want to expose the same functionality and others can use this functionality. Okay, so using the web services, we can expose some functionalities so that others can make use of that functionality. If you see the free web services, any Google, you can find some number of web services like temperature converter, currency converter, okay, currency converter. These are all the free available web services. So you can call this one currency, and if you want to transform a currency from India to US, you can input the Indian currency, you can give the response of the US currency. Likewise, okay, so a functionality that is available on the web, that is called a web service. So you can, then the other thing is how to call that web service. Okay, you develop a functionality and others can make use of that functionality, and you need to expose, guys, hello, if you want to consume my service, you need to provide some rules and regulations. Using that, send me your request, I will process the request and send you back the response. Okay, so that rules and responsibilities are defined by the protocol using the SOAP or REST. Using the SOAP, there are some specific rules defined. If you need to the, you need to the SOAP request so that it process and use back the SOAP response. Okay, so now what happens is slowly web services coming to picture. Okay, now then you need to develop some functionalities and expose the functionality to outside world, and you need to consume the services developed by the other third parties in your application. Okay, you need to consume the web services developed in your application, right? And you need to, at the same time, you need to expose the some functionalities to other counterparts of your application or other external clients. So now, in order to access this web service, you don't require any UI. Okay, in order to access the web service, you don't require any UI. Whereas the functionality developed in earlier enterprise applications, from UI, from user interface, you will access that functionality, right? So in order to interact with this web service, you don't require any screen. The functionality is there, and you need to send the request defined in the protocol format. But suppose you're accessing the SOAP web service, you need to send the SOAP request and it responds the SOAP response. Okay. All right. So how it happens means you need to know, right? Means you expose the functionality and your client want to make use of that functionality, then you need to tell your client, right, boss, this is the functionality, right? Or suppose you expose some currency converter functionality, right? If you expose the currency converter functionality and your client want to make use of this currency converter functionality, then you need to tell your client, right, boss, to interact with my web service, you need to use this input, some currency input, so that I can provide you the, you can give me the some input and in what currency you want to exchange that input. Suppose you want to convert the Indian rupee to US dollars, you need to give the Indian and US dollars a number of rupees you want to convert, so that my response will give back the that response, the converted US dollars. So these things, all things you need to define inside a integration document called a visual document. Okay. WSDL document contains all the details of the web service in case of SOAP. Right? So this visual document contains where actually the SOAP service is up and running. Okay. What are the inputs required to invoke this web service? Where actually the SOAP service is up and running, what are the inputs required to invoke this web service, and what response is back to client? Which is a request and response. So this information is there in the visual document on a brief. It has some other information, but on a whole, it has the web service point information, what it required to invoke the service, and what response is used back to client. So see, now what happens is I am using web services now. Krishna, you are following. I'm going fast, I'm going too slow. Please give me your views here. Therefore, I'm confused. Hello?
Continue, sir.
You're able to follow my call?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I'm seeing Shiva. Hi, Shiva. This is Prasad.
Hello. Hi, sir.
Yeah, okay. I'm having the 10 years of learning some experience in Java J2E and
application
platform.
Yeah.
So what about you? What's your background?
I did my master's in computer science, sir, but my bachelor's I did it in electronics and communication.
Okay.
Yeah, and I don't have any IT experience.
Okay. So you have knowledge on Java, right? Basic knowledge on Java.
I have the basic knowledge.
Yeah. Okay, that would be fine. You can able to, of course, without an issue. If you have Java, that would be fine.
Okay.
So now I'm telling about how two entities are integrated. Means ESB is a major and integration platform. So before coming to Mule, why this ESB is coming to picture and what is an ESB?
Okay.
So if you have the, suppose two applications you want to integrate, ESB integration, right? You want to integrate application A, app A, and app B. You want to integrate app A and app B. Since app B is a service provider, app B provides some service, and app A consumes that service. Okay. Then app B publishes a document, visual document. The document has all the details about this service, means address, where you can find that service, and the request format and the response, right? Using all these things, app A designed its code and hit the service developed, deployed in the app B. Okay, but suppose this is deployed in some IP address like 10.1 dot something IP address. This app B services is deployed, and app A start communicating with that service. Okay, then over a period of time, what happens is app B changing this is infrastructure, moving all the services to the different infrastructure. Okay, then what about app A? If the app will break or not? No, guys, any What is your idea?
Yes, it will break.
Okay. It's breaking.
1 second. Hello?
Hello, yes, yes.
Yeah, API is a service provider or app is a service provider?
App B is service provider and okay. App A is consumer.
Okay.
And App A is consuming the services provided by App B.
Okay.
If App B changing infrastructure, App B moving all the services to different machine.
Okay.
Then App A designed the code. Okay. Taking address and all these parts into consideration.
Okay.
If the endpoint of App B changes, now App B is providing a service in the new endpoint, new machine.
Okay.
Okay. Then what about App A? App A need to change, right? Instead App A also, you need to change that to new environment. Okay. Yeah. Now App A need to point to the new environment, from the old environment. Then App A will break. Until we need to, if you change it, if this you change a newer new IP, then App A will work.
Okay.
So there is a dependency between, try to point to point dependency between App A and App B.
Yeah.
Okay, because you integrated all, you developed all the code based on the app.
Yeah. Right?
So if I design the same architecture like this,
hello.
If, but suppose. 1 second, same App A. App A is consumer and App B is provider. Okay. What happens is now this is my App A code and this is the App B functionality, whatever service. I don't strictly I will call this service. I can use one thing called an adapter, mediator, some middleman. Okay. Whatever the app B produces, it places in one area called a message channel. Message channel simply assume a place. Okay. And this middleman picks that message and start communicating with the app B. Okay. When app B responds, it gives to this adapter and it posts to the one more channel and App A picks that message. Function picks that message. Now in this type of architecture, okay, if you designed the communication in this manner, if any changes happens in App B moving to different machine or any changes happens in App B, is this code impacts? Yes, able to follow me? And it looks like Greek Latin like that.
One.
Guys?
Yeah.
Okay. If I design architecture in this manner, I introduce a middleman. I don't want to directly communicate with App A and App B. I remove the direct communication. I introduce a middleman like some mediator. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Now, App A responsibility. This is just whatever you want to send request place in one place. Okay. And this middleman picks that message and start communicating with the target producer, right? So in this type of architecture, if App B changes his code or App B moving to different type, different machine, different infrastructure, is the code defined in App A will break or not? No idea.
Can you repeat?
Okay, see. Earlier in the earlier case, the two apps API and APB. Okay, API is communicating directly with APB. API running in some IP address like 10.2.124.185, something like that. I coded, okay, boss, go this IP address and invoke this service. I can design API like that. It will communicate with APB using this all these codes, IP address, service, all these things. Okay. Now, if APB changes to different environment, different machine, my API will break because I use the old IP address. Now APB is running in the new IP address. Until unless I change and go and change the IP address inside API, my API won't work. Right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if API changes in new address, I need to update that address inside API. Then only API start communicating with the new address and API will work. So what I did is I isolated API code, okay, and I introduced some middleman adapter. Okay, whatever API want to communicating with API, it places it in message channel. I hearing lot of background noise. Could you mute yourself if not speaking? Okay, so now suppose APB is running one machine, if API code, whatever you want to API send request to APB, if they just place in a message channel, it won't interact directly. And there is some adapter, what it does is it picks the message channel and start communicating with the APB. Okay. So if any change happened app B, does my code defined in API will impact or not?
If you introduce Mule or middleman, there is no need to worry about API. Whatever changes happen in app B, no need to worry.
Yeah, good. So now, if any change happen or app B, we need to do configuration in this middleman. Okay, right. So my code of APB doesn't have any impact. The changes happened by the APB. Okay, I can isolate the API code with the changes. Got it. If it AB, if APB running a new IP address, I will update the IP address in this thing. Adapter level. I don't go and change in the code level. Got it, right?
Yes.
Any doubt in?
No.
Okay. Now, one second. So take one scenario, okay. Okay. In your application, you want to integrate the different types of web services. It may be SOAP or REST, whatever. You need to integrate different types of web services, right? In this integration, your target web service may expecting some data format, but your app is delivering request in some data format, right? So usually what happens, first of all, this is your application. Okay, your application is producing some XML format. Some XML format, right? But your target, once your producer, whatever the service provider, that service provider expecting his service to receive a JSON format. If you give JSON, then only it process the request. You won't expect the XML format. Then your responsibility to convert this XML to JSON and provides the JSON to your producer, right? So earlier what happened, you need to write some transformation code to transform your XML to JSON. That is your responsibility to transform your XML to JSON and use the JSON to your service provider. Okay, so what I do is, rather than transforming, writing my own code, I will engage one guy called a transformer. Okay, so whatever the request my APA want to send to this service provider, I place that request in one message channel, one place where the transformer picks that message and he transforms XML message to JSON. Okay, and he gives the JSON to your producer, because your producer expecting the JSON, right? Whatever response your producer sent back to your JSON, takes the JSON and converts back to XML and used to your application. So your application make use of that XML file, right? So your responsibility of writing these transformers, I delegated to a guy called a transformer. So in the earlier example, we discussed about the adapter, right? Adapter is guy to, he will communicate to your web service adapter. In this example, I told about a transformer. So transformer is a guy transforms one data format to other data format, right? So tomorrow, if you any transformation, so what you guys is, boss, I'm no more accepting the JSON format. I'm accepting some XML format. Okay, then you remove this XML to JSON transformer and you put XML to XML transformer. Okay, so that your source code doesn't have any impact by the changes happening on the provider end. You need to change the corresponding transformers or adapters. Okay guys, is it fine? Any doubt in this area?
No sir.
You are comfortable or feeling, means how you're feeling about this background concepts?
Can you explain me like the difference between adapter and transformer?
Yeah, sure. Definitely. So in case of adapter, okay, adapter, in case of adapter, for suppose you want to connect to the Facebook, example, you want to connect to Facebook and you want to share some pics, suppose. Then share Facebook will expose that in a web service. Right? One second. Ganesh garu oka telugu parent manandi oka 15 minutes undi hello
yes sir
yeah If Facebook is, exposes a functionality, right? Adapter is a guy. Adapter or connector is a guy who know how to talk with the Facebook. Okay, the logic defined inside your adapter, how to talk with the Facebook, right? So earlier, whatever application you are developing, you need to develop the logic how to connect to the Facebook and how to do all the things. Now you remove that logic from your application, you developed an adapter, Facebook adapter, like Facebook connector, make connector adapter, what are different terms with them? Facebook adapter, you delegated that functionality to this adapter, and your application will just communicate with this thing, and he knows how to talk with the Facebook. Okay, so he communicates the Facebook and gives response to your application. Tomorrow you remove the Facebook, you want to talk with the Twitter, or suppose. Okay, now what happens is you remove this adapter and in turn you place the Twitter adapter. This guy know how to talk with the Twitter. Okay, you remove the Facebook adapter, you place the Twitter adapter. So now your application doesn't have any impact by changing this endpoints, these providers. You just delegated this communication to an adapter. Okay, so that is the adapter. Well, coming to transformer, okay, what's up, course? The transformer, Facebook expects its request in a JSON format. Facebook expert request in JSON format. Okay, but what your application you are developing can't have the JSON format, is producing the XML format. Then your responsibility to transform that XML content into the JSON format, right? Your responsibility to transform the XML content to JSON format. Rather than I'm transforming, I'm delegating that to a transformer. So my transformer transforms XML to JSON. Okay. And it gives that JSON to a provider. And takes the JSON from your service provider and transforms back to XML and gives to your application. Okay. Now the Facebook is expecting the JSON format, or suppose some other some Twitter, you take the Twitter expecting the same service in a different data format, some Excel format like that. Okay, now what happens is you remove the transformer, you add one more transformer to communicate with the Twitter, and the same XML you pass to transformer, and transformer will transform XML to Excel format and communicate with Twitter. So what happens is now there is the transforming responsibility of the application, you delegate into different type of transformers. Okay, they know how to transform a content, one form of content to other format, and then they start communicating with your service providers. Okay, now you are free from transforming, you are free from communicating, right? If any changes happens in the adapter level, if you communicate the Facebook, your Twitter, some other, you change the adapter, you won't change the source code. if any data format happens, if Facebook expecting JSON or XYZ format, whatever format, you do change the format if you do the transformer, not your source code. So your source code is free from all these changes, either your endpoint changes or your transformation changes, your source code is free, right? Got a difference? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. So, so you have, one second. This is your client application, and this is your service provider. My pen is not writing good, so it's going like that. You have to change the pen. Okay. See, this is your client application. This is your service provider. Provider application. Then your client application, based on some condition, it need to send message to the service provider. Okay, or suppose you are developing some application. If the user age is above 60 years only, they need to call this service provided by your service provider. If user age is below 60 years, there is no use of calling this service. Okay. Then what happens is you need to write the logic over here. Okay. If the user age is above 60 years, then access this service. So, and then writing that type of logic, I can engage a guy called a filter. Okay. Your application just gives the message to the filter. You define that condition inside your filter. Whatever the condition you define is a filter. Your messages is a message passes the condition, then only it gives interact with your provider. Whatever if message is not passing the condition, but suppose you send a message that is below 60 years, that checks the message, the condition is not passed, then it drops here itself. Okay. So you can develop n number of filters. You can delegate that filters. Rather than writing that own conditions inside your client application, you can configure a filter. The filter take care of all these things, right? So we discussed about adapters, transformers, filters, three types of components. Any doubt on these three components? Okay. Shall I go ahead?
Yes.
And this is your app. Okay, you want to communicate with app using either Facebook or Twitter. Facebook or Twitter. Okay, based on some condition. Okay, for some type of messages you want to store interact with the Facebook, and for some type of messages you want to interact with the Twitter. Okay, this is your client app, and you need to define some condition. What type of messages you want to send to Twitter, and what type of messages you want to send to transformer. Okay, listen carefully. There is, so I don't write all this type of the routing logic inside my app. What need to send to Facebook and what need to send to Twitter, I engage one guy called the router. Okay, so I configure the condition inside the router. For message, I send the message to the router. Router check the message. Based on the condition, he routes either to Facebook or Twitter. Okay, so I don't write any routing logic inside my app. I just delegate the routing logic to a router. Right? So router take care of all this routing to different endpoints. So this enterprise service bus we discussed about, it contains all these components. Okay, all these components like connectors or adapters. Connector know how to connect with different endpoints like Facebook, Twitter, all these things. Connector know. Connector have knowledge of this connecting two different endpoints. Transformers, it know how to transform one format to other format. Okay, XML to JSON, JSON to XML, whatever. Filter, we configure some condition inside the filter. If condition passes, then only the message is sent to next phase place or next provider. Filters, transformers, filters, and routers. Router route the message based on some condition to different endpoints. Okay, so enterprise service bus is constituted of all these components, integration components, connectors, transformers, filters, and routers. Okay. And ESB inside the Mule provides all these out of box. Means if you want to, you don't need to develop your own transformers, your own routers, your own connectors, filters. Mule comes with a bunch of all the transformers, routers, filters, all those things. So just you need to configure inside your application. All the Mule provides all these components, integration components. You need to just configure. You need not develop all this your own transformers or filters, but depends upon some specific customized conditions. You may develop the transformer, but for generic purpose, Mule provides all these transformer filter routers. Just you can consume that your application, integration application. Okay, so Mule is packed with all these integration components. It is called an enterprise service bus. Usually, if you arrange all the integration components inside like this, it is called service bus. Okay, it provides enterprise capabilities like security, transaction, all those things. So Mule you can call as an enterprise service bus, ESB. Got it. So in the Mule, let me explain about this. Mule we developed in a IDE called Anypoint Studio. Okay. If you have some Java background, you might have heard about Eclipse. Eclipse is a platform where you can develop your Java programs. So Anypoint also extension of the Eclipse. They add some Mule related plugins to the Eclipse and they developed Anypoint Studio. So if you see the Anypoint Studio, you can have some idea about the Mule. Any doubts so far? Any questions?
One minute. Hello?
Yeah, please. Hello? Please, I want to make this session more interactive. Okay, it's like one-way traffic. I will explain.
Okay, so far is okay. Can you simply tell what SOAP service and RESTful service means?
SOAP service, see one thing. So this is your Anypoint Studio, okay, where you can find all the integration components. See here, these components, right? I told about transformers. These are different transformers available.
Okay.
You can make use of all these transformers, okay? And these are all the filters. These are filters available, and you have connectors. Facebook connector, database connector, file connector, different connectors are available over here. Okay, so just you can drag and drop those connector or filter inside your this canvas area, and you want to connect config database, just drag and drop it, this database component, and you can just to configure the database, you can start interacting with database. Okay. If you want to create a new project, just start a new project. So if you open this demo project I just created, then the project has, we need to, you want to develop some simple application, you can interact with your browser. And from the browser, you can interact with this Mule application using the config HTTP connector. And what you want to send some hello to the your browser, your Chrome browser, like that, something like that. I will explain you what is the connector and how to configure the connector. Run this project, just right click on the demo so that it's start, this project started. So what is the difference between SOAP and REST? SOAP follows a different package structure, okay? Whereas REST, you can use the HTTP methods. One second, let me explain something. For SOAP, we need to develop the XML schemas. It majored on XML only. SOAP is not on JSON. You need to develop the XML schema rules. Okay. Based on the schema, you can design what is your request and what is the response. Your expected request response. You define service like this on the XML. Okay. And it follows, you package the SOAP in a SOAP packaging structure. It has some simple object access protocol SOAP package structure. This package you need to pass over HTTP or JMS, these are different protocols. You can use any protocol to transfer this SOAP message from your client to a provider. Okay, SMTP, you can use these three types of protocols usually. Okay, SOAP package, you will package your request response and SOAP. And the SOAP is developed between, communicated between, the SOAP package is communicated between your service requester and service provider. Okay, so whatever your request, you're going back and forth in a SOAP format. Whereas coming to REST, REST majorly concentrate on the protocol methods. Like REST, in REST everything, suppose you want to access some person accounts, you want to access some person details or address details, all these things you designed using an URL to access a person, HTTP, some your address, or suppose your website xyz.com, pen is not going properly, sorry, I'm from there, xyz.com/person to retrieve the address xyz.com/address. For everything there is an resource you represented in URL interest. Okay, so HTTP has some methods like get, to post, put. Using that you can communicate between your client app will communicate with the provider app using HTTP methods. Okay, those are all on the one second. In REST, we can use the XML or JSON, both are valid, XML or JSON, because it's not defined, the XML means the request response are not defined any schema level over here. Okay, using the HTTP methods, you're accessing the resources. Resources means addresses only in the REST. All right. Now, so your request and response designed in a request response in a schema. You package the request response in a SOAP messaging and you start communicating between your applications. Okay, that is the difference between your SOAP and REST majorly. One second. Not have your application deployed. So you see that my application is running on the port number 8081. Ganesh, you are connecting. Yeah, connect, Ganesh, connecting. Now we see the HTTP. Hello, that was sent, it involves a mule flow, and what is the mule flow I'm setting payload, that is displaying over here. Okay, okay, this is a simple introduction about your, what is an ESB, what different components of ESB and Anypoint Studio. Okay, just I developed a small program in Anypoint Studio. All right guys, any doubts on so far? Hello, Manoj, Shiva.
That's okay. Yes, sir. Can you show again, like how you deployed that flow?
Yeah, simply. See, now it's keep running. Right click. That's it. We deploy. The idea is basically to deploy the composite simply by right clicking. You can show the options to deploy.
And why did you type that hello?
Yes, just demo purpose. I want to return this response message back to the browser. Okay, whatever payload, this is transferred back to your browser. That you are seeing over here. Hello. Okay.
Yes. Got it.
So I'm stopping session here.
Okay.
Thank you guys. Thank you for listening my session.